Hi guys, Keto Phoenix here, and welcome back to another one of my videos. I want to start out by saying that I am not a healthcare provider in any means. I'm not a trainer. All of this information, all these tips, everything I'm giving you are just things I've learned in my own personal life and in my own personal journey. So you have to do what's good for your body, and I would definitely talk to your doctor before, you try any training regimen. I've been in three 5K races now. I did a race yesterday. This is my number. So I was number 96 and I actually did pretty well. There was a lot of, and this was more of a professional race. It wasn't a charity race. It was like a race. So there was over 100 people there. So it was like the biggest race I personally had ever run in. These tips that I'm giving you are things that I've learned in the course of 7 weeks of training and having ran three races now. I really thought hard about this and I tried to pick some things that not a lot of YouTubers talk about when it comes to running. So I've got my list written down because I have a tendency to ramble and I want to try to stay on track so this video isn't, 2 hours long. So let's get right into it. So number one is going to be gear. And yes, everybody talks about this and there's a reason for it. Okay. Gear is important. Okay. First off, you have your shoes. When I first started running, I did not have the proper shoes. I was wearing shoes that I had been wearing for years. So the sole was completely gone. I had developed a hole in one of my toes. When I first started running, I ended up with quite a bit of ankle pain. And that was attributed to just horrible running shoes. So I suggest that if you're thinking about starting a Couch to 5K, make sure that your shoes are your priority. And there's tons of ways about going and getting a decent pair of shoes. Like I just went on Amazon and I just picked a pair. I made sure to size up a half. So I normally I'm a 7.5, so I bought a size 8 because when you run, your feet will swell up and get bigger. So you want to make sure that you have room. Most people go up a full size, and I don't know, I might try that, but right now the half size seems to be doing okay for me. As for clothing, whatever it is that you guys train in, it will be fine. Just make sure that when you're getting ready to run your first race, that you're wearing clothes that you're comfortable with, clothes you've tried on already, clothes that you've already ran in so that you know it's gonna work. The last thing you wanna do is buy new clothes, new shoes, new socks, things that you've never tried before in your life, and then go run your 5K race with because they might not work. So then your race could be miserable. You could have rubbage and create rashes. Your shoes could be not the right kind of shoe, and then you get back from your race and you've got blisters. So just make sure that when you race, you're wearing whatever clothes it is that you have been training in and that you know that works. Stick with what's comfortable. Tip
Okay.
number two, training method. Okay, this is really important. So you guys have to find a method, a training method that works for you guys. You've got to trust the process of the method, okay? Definitely go online and find yourself a plan that seems like it's something that would be doable for you guys to do. And there are tons of training plans out there. You just go onto Google and you can Google it. They're all different, which is perfect for you. But you can look at something and see a training plan where it has you running, starting out running 2 minutes. And you can look at that and go, nope, that's not going to be for me. I can't run 2 minutes. And then you're just going to pass that and go to a different one.
Okay.
Tip number three kind of falls in with tip number two, and that's don't be afraid to change. So I know I said that you have to find a training method and you have to stick with that. And what I mean by stick with that is you have to stick with a training method, okay? You start out doing that and you realize that one, it's too hard, you need a different one, or it's too easy and you need to, level up some, right? You just got to listen to your body. And if you're doing a training method and you're trying to stick it out for weeks, like, and it's miserable and you hate it, you're going to be less likely to want to get up the next day and run. Training and running is going to have, you're going to have days where obviously you're going to hate it, but you're going to know if the training method that you had picked works for you. I did that a few times in the course of my 7 weeks of training. And I also learned that doing training methods that talk to you in miles instead of minutes was also something I couldn't do. When I had a training method that said, go out and run a mile today, it was really hard for me. You know, I need the ability to just go out and run. And if I have to be paying attention to how far I'm going in distance in miles, I find myself constantly looking at my watch, right? Like, oh my gosh, I'm not there yet. Oh my gosh, I'm not there yet. And that just added a level of frustration that I just couldn't handle. It was easier for me to just go, okay, they want me to run so many minutes today, set the timer on my phone, turn on my music, stick my phone in my pocket, and just ignore it, right? Just go run, listen to my music, and I know I'm done when my phone goes off. These are things you're going to learn about yourself. So again, don't be afraid to change if that's what you guys need to do. Tip number four, we're going to talk about music. And this is another tip that people have, you know, put on YouTube, and it's important. And I'm going to talk about this because when I was talking to you earlier about that mile and a half that I was supposed to run, I did not have my music. I didn't have a playlist set up. I was just listening to Pandora. I don't know what was going on. I mean, it was a very windy day, so I'm thinking that some towers might have been down or something. So then I was trying to huff that full mile and a half without being able to listen to anything. It helps in so many ways. It helps pace me. I use the beat of the songs to help pace my steps when I'm really in my head feeling like I can't do something or, you know, like, you know, I get a little negative into my head. Then it's easy for me to just stop and just listen to the music, listen to the words of the song. You know, I pick very inspirational music, things that, you know, help me feel motivated, like Stand Tall, you know, This Is Your Fight song, you know, things like that. Very motivational songs that just really make you feel good, feel empowered, right? And I use those to help empower me and to focus on something other than what my brain is trying to tell me. Definitely make sure that you have a playlist, something that is actually completely downloaded on your phone, so that if you go, say you have to go for a run up in the mountains or something like that, right? Then you'll already have a downloaded list that you can play whether you have service or not. Number five is your pace. I will admit I have been guilty of really focusing on my pace when I'm running. And sometimes I can get a little discouraged. Like when I first started running, I looked at my pace and it was like 15 minutes a mile. And I'm going, I am so slow. I had to remind myself that I was just starting out. I have a long ways to go and it's important to go slow, right? Take it easy. Don't just go out the door and start running. This is about distance, not speed. Everybody has to work towards it. Number six, resting. Make sure that whatever training plan you do has rest days. Train 3 days a week with a rest day in between them. And I've seen people on YouTube, they're running every single day. They're running way beyond what they should be running. They're doing no walking. They go from being on the couch to trying to run 5 or 6 miles and they burn out. They end up injuring themselves. They have to cancel their races because their doctors have told them they can't run for 6 weeks. Right. And it's all because they're not training properly. They're not resting. Your body has to rest. Number seven, commitment. This one's a tough one to talk about because I realize that we're all busy people and we have jobs and we have to work around our jobs, our work schedule. Sometimes things come along, you know, in our personal lives and that can make it hard. Just do the best that you guys can to stick to the schedule that you can. You know your life better than anybody else. You know your job, you know your work schedule. So when you're planning your training method, try to plan that around your work schedule as best as you can. But don't just go, oh, well, I have this today, so I couldn't run at all. No, take that running and switch it to a different time. You have to try to stay committed to running. That's the only way that I've been able to do my training. It's the only reason why I am where I am, is because I have pushed myself, even when my schedule was hard, even when I didn't think I was going to be able to fit it in. I found a way to fit it in. I'm to prioritize the important things. And if this is something you're genuinely committed into wanting to do, say you've signed up for your 5K race, you want to do this. You need to be committed to it because if you don't and you get to that 5K race and you run it, it doesn't turn out the way you want and you get disappointed and you give up and you blame running, like running's horrible, running's awful, right? But it's not. You weren't committed to doing it. All I'm saying is if for whatever reason, something, say you get really sick and you can't run for a week, what I would do is say you only completed week one and then you got sick for a whole week and then you couldn't do week two. Take care of your sickness and then restart week one. Say you get into week four, you just completed week four and then you got sick and you had to take 1 or 2 weeks off and then you get back on. Don't just go straight into week five, repeat week four. So whatever week it was that you had completed before you having to stop, repeat that week. Don't continue forward, because it's meant, each week is meant to make it a little bit more intense and a little bit more intense from what you had done previously. And if you took a couple weeks off and try to do the next week, you're going to be at a level of intensity that you're not going to be able to handle. So go back. Don't be afraid to go back, and don't feel bad for having to do that, because if you had something happen that was out of your control, right, then just go back and repeat the week that you had finished. But don't give up and try your best to prioritize it as much as you can. Tip number 8 is walk to run. So this kind of ties in with, you know, quite a bit of the things that I've been talking about training methods and not being afraid to walk and things like that. It's important to build yourself up slowly, right? You will start out walking more than you're running, but then eventually that's going to change. Before you know it, you'll be running more than you're walking. And then next thing you know, you're going to be running and there'll be no walking. I feel that when I started my Couch to 5K training, it was a little bit easier for me, because even though I wasn't a runner and I wasn't doing any running, I was walking with my dog and we were walking about 3 miles every single day. And I had been doing that for about 3 months. You haven't signed up for a 5K yet. Maybe you're just thinking about doing Couch to 5K, right? What I suggest you guys do is take that first month and just walk. Try to increase your steps to like maybe 10,000 steps a day. And then you're going to find that when you're ready to start doing your Couch to 5K, it's going to be a little less harsh, because you've already gotten your body up and used to your body moving and functioning. And I feel that that's what helped me immensely when I did finally start running. So tip number 9, and this is for keto, eat and drink for the next day. When you eat carbs and you're a runner, you burn through carbs really fast. And that's why when runners are doing any running beyond 6 miles, they always suggest you bring like gels and you know, things that you can eat to help replenish the carbs that you're expiring, right? Because carbs are just, they burn through your body super fast. And that's what your body is used to consuming. They're used to consuming the carbs for fuel. And so they need those carbs in order to run. But keto is different. When you're on the ketogenic diet, you're not using carbs to burn for fuel. You are training your body to use its own fats and its own stores for that energy. Okay. So the one thing that runners will tell you about the keto diet is that you can't eat something, you know, that's high in protein and high in fat right before your run, because it takes your body a lot longer to process those foods than it does carbs. Carbs is a quick way to get energy quickly and then burn through it quickly. Now, fats and proteins, yes, they do take longer for your body to process. However, they also sustain and help you last a lot longer. So think of it like this. Carbs are a nice, soft, dry piece of wood in a fire, okay? Whereas the ketogenic diet is an 8-hour log. The carb log is going to, you're going to burn through that really fast, and you're going to have to keep adding logs to keep your energy, to keep that fire going, versus an 8-hour log that you can just stick in the fire and you're good to go for 8 hours, right? So if you are watching this and you're already on keto and you're thinking about training, think of it like this, okay? So you're on a rest day, the next day is train day, or maybe it's a race, okay? You need to be getting in your fats and your proteins and things like that, and even your healthy carbs, really getting them in there. And your body will digest and process them through the night while you're sleeping. So when you wake up the next morning, you're going to be ready to go. You know, so that's why I say you need to eat and drink for the next day. So your water, here's, you know, I've got this with me. I'm drinking my water and I'm thinking of it in the mindset that, you know, I'm going to be running tomorrow. I'm going to be getting up early. The last thing I want to do is chug water right before I go for a run. You need to drink your water today to use for tomorrow. And the same thing with tomorrow. Drink your water tomorrow to use for the next day, right? If that makes sense. Okay. Number 10. And you guys have, if you're not new to my channel, if you've watched previous videos of mine, you will have heard me talk about this many times. And that's your mindset. Very important. Your mind is going to play tricks on you. Okay. It's going to tell you you're tired and it's going to tell you to stop. It's going to tell you that you can't do this. I find that when I'm running, it's kind of meditative, right? Like I think about all sorts of things when I'm running, and it helps me not think about being tired because my brain's trying to tell me I'm tired, but I'm not. I know I'm not. I know I can go farther. I was really battling my mind in my race yesterday. I mean, I knew that I was going faster than I normally would. And I battled my mind the entire time. I think by the time I was done with my race, I was excited that I had finished it. I was excited that I managed to run the whole thing without walking. But I was also mentally exhausted because I had fought my brain the entire time. Like there were so many times that I was like, no, I can't do this anymore. I need to walk. And then I was like, no, Susan, you can do this. You know what to do. You've trained for this. You know, I'm pretty much up to running 4 miles. Okay. I'm up to running 4 miles a day now. And so I know that I can run a 5K without stopping. At first, I didn't know why I was struggling so much. It wasn't until after I got done with the race and I was looking at my splits that I had realized that I had been going so much faster. Runners in videos will tell you that some days running is super easy and then other days it's super hard. And it can be frustrating because you can have 2 days where you just felt like you're on top of the world. And then you get to your third run day and it just feels like you just took 60 steps back because for whatever reason that day you're feeling more tired, more exhausted, you know, and it's mainly mindset. And then there's going to be days where you're going to get frustrated because you're going to walk out the door feeling really excited to run. Like you really want to run. You're really excited to do it. And then you're going to get in like 10 minutes and suddenly your mind's like, nope, I'm done. Nope. Let's walk. We don't want to do this. And so I've had days like that too. Where I was like, what? We were just so motivated. What happened? Right. So then again, I had to tune into my legs and I had to tune into my body, right? Because I wanted to make sure that I wasn't injured or anything like that. And then I'm like, I'm feeling fine. This is no big deal. Like I'm not having trouble breathing. I mean, my legs, they're warmed up. They're fired up. There's no pain. We're not tired. Why, you know, be quiet, brain. You don't know what you're talking about and just have to fight it. Tip number 11, don't mess with what works. This one's going to be a quick one. I feel like it ties in with a lot of what I've been saying. Find your clothes, find your training method, find your mindset. Maybe you do yoga, maybe you meditate, whatever it is that you need to do to help with your mindset. All of these things factor in to not messing with what works. So if you've found a whole regimen of things that work for you, they help you get out the door, they help you stay committed, motivated, they've been working for you, they've been working great. Don't just turn around and be like, say you just sat down and watched a YouTube video and somebody on YouTube is doing something completely different from you. And you're going, well, maybe that's why they're better than me. Maybe I need to change what I'm doing so that I can improve faster, right? No. Don't do that. If whatever it is you guys are doing right now is working for you, all of it is working. Don't change it. Number 12, race day high. I feel like this needs to be explained. In all three races that I have done, like, and I've heard people talk about this before, it is so true. You are going to push yourself so much harder and so much faster because you're seeing all of these people out here. They're fit. They've also obviously been racing for a really long time, and you're going to find yourself pushing yourself. Like, I feel like that's part of why I ended up with a 9-minute pace in my race yesterday, because like I was trying to keep up with other people. When you're starting out in a race, your first 5K race, there's people that are going to just be zooming past you. Okay. And you're going to be thinking, oh, I've got to go fast too. No, stick with what you've been training. Okay. Stick to your pace and you'll be amazed. Don't let what other people are doing affect you. Because if you start out fast, like everybody else is starting out fast, you're going to burn yourself out so quickly, and then you're going to feel disappointed because you couldn't do it. Don't get into that hype, okay? Just breathe, center yourself, and then just think of your race day as just another training day, okay? You just went out the door and you're just running. Also, for race day hype, I don't think a lot of people talk about is there's going to be times during a race that you might be running in terrain that you have never ran in before. This happened to me in this last race. I got super lucky that I didn't really hurt myself. I'm used to running on cement, concrete, roads, sidewalks, things like that, right? I don't run in grass. I haven't done any of my training in grass, like at all. But then right before the finish, right? And when it comes to the finish, that's when I like to give myself my last oomph and really go forward, right? And there was somebody in front of me and I knew I wanted to pass her before the finish line. I managed to pass her, but my foot hit a pothole or like a little divot in the grass that I didn't see. And I kind of rolled my good ankle. I was fortunate in the fact that it didn't sprain it. It didn't hurt it in any way. So I'm perfectly fine. I feel blessed that I didn't, because last thing I need is to hurt ankles. I praise God that I didn't hurt myself too bad. Study your map. Study where you're going to be running. And so that way you can plan where you want to speed up and where you want to slow down. And so then that way, when you get into that race day high, you'll already have yourself so planned out that it shouldn't affect you too much because you already know what you're going to do. Tip number 13 is deal with problems immediately. It goes for training and races. I touched on this a little bit in a previous video. I had gotten a wood chip stuck in my shoe. It just like flipped up into my shoe. And I knew it was there, but my timer hadn't gone off yet. I really didn't want to stop running. It was a bad mindset day. And I felt that if I would have stopped to take care of the issue, I probably would have, I was worried that I wouldn't want to get back up and start running again. So I just left it and I finished my run. And it was the dumbest thing I could have ever done. And I know better. Like, I'm a mom of three kids, right? And my husband is retired military. I know these things. I have no excuse. It was dumb. I just didn't want to stop. So, you know, even if you have to pause your timer to take care of what it is that you need to take care of, do that. Take care of it. Tip 14, breathing exercises. I've started practicing breathing exercises on my rest days so that I can implement them on my run days, and they have been helping out a lot. So what you want to do is you want to start like, and you can research breathing exercises and do them differently, but what I started out doing is I started laying on the floor with my knees planted on the floor. I put one hand right on my chest and one on my upper stomach. And then I breathe in deep. So I expand my hands out, right? So you breathe in deep and let it out. And then breathe in. Then breathe out. Right. And I just close my eyes. I focus on that deep breathing and what it's doing for my hands. Like, I'm pressing in when I breathe it in, and I'm pressing out on my hands when I'm breathing out. Right. And so I started out doing that, and for like 10 minutes a day, every single day, laying down. And then eventually I did that to where I was standing up and practicing it like sitting or standing. And then I started really focusing on my breathing counts. So when I started getting really tired, and I would focus on my breathing, and that helped me out a lot. Like in my race yesterday, when I was like, again, I was battling my mindset and feeling tired. I just took time. I'm listening to my music in my headphones, and I just took time to just focus on my breathing. So then I would breathe in deep and count 1, 2, then breathe out 1, 2, breathe in 1, 2, breathe out 1, 2. And then there for a good like 10 minutes of that race, that run, that was all I was doing, was just counting my breaths, breathing them in and breathing them out. And sometimes it's not easy. It's hard. When you're running, it is hard to want to take a deep breath in, because you just want to get as much oxygen in your lungs as you can. So we have a tendency to really go, you know, because we're trying to get as much oxygen into our lungs as we can. And the last thing we want to do is just sit there and, right? And my last tip for you is something that I've never heard anybody talk about. I actually had to Google it, and maybe it's because not everybody experiences it, but I definitely have. My tip number 15 for you guys is the after run chills. I had never even known this was a thing. Every time I go for a run, after race days, things like that, suddenly, like I'll be sitting down, and originally I'm hot, right? Like I'm covered in sweat. I'm super hot. I feel like I'm dying. And then maybe like 15, 20 minutes later, I am ice cold. Like it's 90 degrees outside and I am sitting on my porch steps with the sun on me because I am so, so cold. And I was worried about it. I was like, why am I so cold, right? And again, I'm not a doctor, you know, I didn't know this stuff, right? And then once I looked it up, it was like, okay, yeah, you know, that makes sense, right? Because, and the whole point is like when you're running, your body's core temperature rises and this triggers the mechanisms in your body that want to help it cool down, right? So that's why you sweat. Your body's overheated. And so your body's like, okay, so time to trigger mechanisms to cool ourselves down. So we're going to start sweating to help cool the body temperature down. And also your blood vessels dilate, right? And this helps with the sweat evaporation. So when you're running, basically your blood vessels, they are reprioritizing where your blood flow is, right? It's sending extra blood to your muscles so that they can get enough oxygen and nutrients to be operating. What happens to your body when you stop running? Your body's metabolic heat production drops, but you will continue sweating. That's what makes you feel cold because you're sweating. And so therefore you're losing heat through the evaporation process. And then also your blood vessels start constricting. And so therefore your blood flow decreases. And this helps your body temp return back down to resting state. And this can also, you know, make you feel cold. So then when you stop exercising, it takes your body some time to redistribute blood back to, you know, its normal non-running pattern. And all of these things can contribute into why you get these after runner chills. So if you get the after run chills, it's completely normal. It's fine. Just dry yourself off, take a warm shower. After you've cooled off a little bit, right? Then, you know, I always, after I took my warm showers, I was always fine after that. I hope some of these tips helped you guys. And if you have any questions for me, feel free to leave them down in the comments below. If you're new here, don't forget to hit that subscribe button. I'll be having lots more tips about running and my journey in these videos, along with keto advice and recipes. I definitely am going to be continuing to film my running journey. I've had people ask me, now that I've run 5K races, where do I plan to go from here? I don't quite know. Right now I'm training for a 10K, but you know what? Eventually I would like to run a half marathon and a full marathon, and then who knows where I will go after that. All I know is I'm having so much fun and I don't want to quit. So I'm just going to keep pushing myself forward and keep going. I hope that I motivate you guys. I will see you guys in my next video. Bye.